we stand our feet this evening and go into worship? Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord tonight? Come on, let's just worship Him tonight. You breathe Your life into my lungs. You bring to life these dry bones. I know my heart, You made Your home.
to a living king tonight.
Come on, just bless him in this place tonight. Thank you, Lord. We just lift you up. We lift praises to your name tonight, God. You're alive forevermore. Come on, just worship him, church.
I sing praises to your name. Praises to your name. The name that's so much higher than all names. All
is hope inside me, hope inside.
Jesus, be lifted higher. Yes, you are so good. Let our praises fill this temple. Let our praises fill this temple. Let our praises fill this temple. You are good. Let our praises fill the temple. Let our praises fill the temple. For you are good. One more time, let our praises fill the temple. Let our praises fill the temple. Let our praises fill the temple. You are good. We lift you up. We lift you up. We lift you a heart and an attitude of worship tonight. I just want to encourage you to lift the name of Jesus high above every circumstance, above every problem. It's so easy to get caught up in the mundane and the day-to-day. A lot of times we forget what our place is or what our lane is or our priority. But when we make God the bigger picture, everything else just kind of falls in the shadows. Problems or mountains that seem to be huge, obstacles that, barriers that seem to be immovable or irreplaceable, those things just become small and insignificant. As our focus is on Him, and I'm reminded of when Jesus bid Peter to walk on the water, told him to come out of the boat and come towards Him, and Peter takes off towards Him with his eyes fixed and focused on Jesus. But the moment that he looks down, gets his eyes off of his destination, his prize, he begins to waver, begins to doubt. And the circumstances begin to overtake him. Jesus reminds him, look up. For He's our help. He's our focus. So let's just lift our eyes and our hearts to Him right now. Yeah. Be reminded of His lordship. Be reminded that He's bigger and greater than any problem, any obstacle. Come on, let's get our eyes on Him tonight. We're going to lift Him up one more time. Sing it out.
Be lifted up. Be lifted higher.
Jesus, Together we sing, we lift you up, Lord. Jesus,
we lift you up.
Yes, Lord,
we lift you higher. Oh. We lift you up. We lift you higher.
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 Yes, Lord. You lift it up.
Come on, come on.
You lift it higher.
Yes.
You lift it up to the highest place. Come on, can you just give him a hand clap of praise? Let's acknowledge that he's at the center of everything that we are and everything that is good tonight, by giving him that hand clap of praise, a shout. Somebody shout glory. Shout hallelujah. It's our highest praise. Amen. Love on someone you're right there around you. Give them a hug. Tell them to be blessed. Find you a seat. Amen.
One of the things I'm so grateful for is that whenever we come into the house of the Lord and we magnify the Lord with me, I want you guys to magnify the Lord with me. Let us magnify him together, because I love that word, because it means that when we magnify him, that it seems like all of our other things get eclipsed and become so small. And I'm thankful for that tonight. Doesn't mean that we forget them. It's just a matter that we actually get to see them in the reality of what God can truly do in our lives. Amen? Amen and amen. So glad you guys are here tonight. It's Wednesday. It is the middle of the week. It's split like a sandwich right down the middle, and I like it. I'm thankful because the mid always just feels like a great time to get to come together, to get to just enjoy what God's doing. And who is ready for the word of the Lord tonight, for the book of Revelation? Oh, yeah. It has been one of the most powerful, impacting studies. And I'll be honest with you, he did this study a few years ago. And a few things I think a few of us might have heard. But now, over the last 2 weeks, I'm starting to get even deeper revelation that I've never heard before. So I am thankful. Tonight is going to be just as amazing. But before we do that, I want to do a couple things. We do want to receive our tithe and offering tonight. And I just want to take this moment that if you've never given here at Expression Church, I want to tell you kind of how you do that. But if you've come prepared to give tonight, go ahead and get your gift ready. If you're giving cash, you can get an offering envelope that's underneath of these beautiful blue chairs. And you can fill it out. Put your name on it. Make sure that you put your name on it, even if you're giving $1, $2. We want to make sure that you get contribution credit at the end of the year for whenever you do file your taxes. So make checks payable to ECH. Then also, if you're text giving tonight, go ahead, and if you've got an iPhone or Android, in your message, put 2, and you're going to put in who you're sending this message to is 84321. That's 84321. Then in the message body, go ahead and put how much you'd like to give, just the actual numerals, and it'll be just like an iTunes account. You just kind of set it up once, and then the next time that you do it, you won't have to worry about it the next time. But if you want to do that, that's how many of our church family gives, and I want to thank you, because we are blessed tonight to be in such an amazing, generous family of God. Not just monetarily, but also with time. time. I got to say a huge shout out to Diane Horner, who came by today. Where's she at? She's in the nursery. She's serving tonight. So there, I mean, many of you just drop by the church and say, I've got an hour. What can I do? And that's what she did today. So we just thank you so much. And this is your home. And don't ever feel like you're coming in and wondering, well, am I supposed to be here? You're supposed to be here. And we're glad you're here. So let's receive our tithe and offering tonight. If you're ready to give, let's do something together. Let's raise our offerings to the Lord. And you guys know the drill. If you don't have to give, but you want to get to a place where you can give eventually, we want to bless your finances tonight. So raise your hand along with our gifts. So let's pray tonight. God, I thank you so much. I thank you. And I come first and foremost with an humble heart, God, with a heart of gratitude that says, thank you. Thank you for life. Thank you for health. Thank you for the opportunity to get to walk through a door to hear the voice of the Lord tonight. Thank you for getting us out of bed to hear the voice of the Lord today. So God, as we receive this offering tonight, God, I thank you, Lord, for every person that has to give and those who maybe don't have to give tonight, God. I just pray a supernatural blessing on their lives, Father. I pray for those that are giving tonight that you continue to increase what they're doing in their everyday life, Father, for you. And God, I thank you for every single gift that's given here tonight, God. You know where every penny goes. And you know, Lord, what upbuilding of your kingdom really looks like. And thank you for giving us a taste of it every single day. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen and amen. Be blessed tonight as you give. I want to tell you also about a couple things tonight. If you noticed, we do not have our youngins with us that are usually in this corner. Well, it's because tonight they launched their weekly Wednesday night service. They love being in worship with us, but I'm really grateful that God has expanded their leadership in an amazing way, and they want to have a weekly time where they come together and do it ESM, Expression Student Ministry style. So we're very thankful they are in the auxiliary sanctuary across the hallway. So we're glad that that's going on. Also, two more things. We're going to be recognizing new members this Sunday. We have quite a few. And if you'd ever wanted to become a member, or maybe you'd like just some more information on what it is to become a member, I want to encourage you, come see myself. I'm going to be here up front afterwards, as well in the Grand Hall. I'd love to talk to you and let you know what that looks like. We'd love to have you become a part of our church family officially. It's an awesome thing. So we want you to have that opportunity, and we're going to be recognizing members this Sunday. Then also, this following Tuesday on September the 11th at 6 o'clock, we're going to be doing a fresh expression class, and that'll be in the auxiliary sanctuary across the hallway. And all that is that gives you a little bit of an idea of who we are, and it also gives us an opportunity to ask who you are. And so you just come prepared to get to enjoy, to share that night, get to be together. So I'm excited. We are in our anniversary month. We have been a church on September the 30th. We will have been a church 5 years. And how fitting is it going into this fall that we are studying something so powerful like the book of Revelation and then what Pastor Kevin's bringing on Sunday mornings about falling into focus. So tonight, Pastor Kevin, is as he comes right now, just open up your hearts and let God just begin to speak. Pastor Kevin.
Here we go. I don't even know where to begin. No, I'm going to stay down here today. I'm just, you don't have to bench press that, though. Curl it. Oh. You know, one of the biggest challenges you face is when you do a series like this, you end up last weekend, I don't even know where we ended up, Revelation chapter 6, I think. But you never know how much to recap. And then when you start recapping, you end up telling everything you said last week all over again or 2 weeks ago. So it's real hard, but if you don't start somewhere, you know, people that weren't here, so that's just the biggest challenge. So I think what I'm going to do tonight, we're only going to recap just a couple of scriptures and then just keep going forward. There is just a lot of ground to cover, and I think Jesus is probably going to come back before I get an opportunity to get through the end of this book. there's just so much. You could spend so many hours just on one verse. Mike's work, we're back there with me tonight, right? Okay, let's do the King James Version. And let's do Psalm 149 as we go into Revelation. Psalm 149. You remember last week we talked about, and they sung a new, in Revelation 5:9, it says they sang a new song, saying, "Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof." We talked about that. Let me tell you what they're saying when they sang that, okay? Or the new song. This is David's psalm, and here's David saying, "Praise ye the Lord." Here we go. "Sing unto the Lord a new song." What I'm doing is I'm giving you some a prophetic picture of David seeing a new covenant, a new song, a new testament, if you will, a new day, a new people. And when David got ready to say this, this goes with this will tell you. It's like a little clue or a little insight of what the book of Revelation is about. So, the new song. This just verifies and stamps the fact that the book of Revelation is a good book. It's a freeing, liberating book. It's a book that tells about Jesus, but it liberates us, okay? It shouldn't scare you, okay? And this is what I'm saying. David says, "Praise ye the Lord, sing unto the Lord a new song, and his praise in the congregation of the saints. Let Israel," because he's in the old covenant here, but he's looking through the cross as a new covenant. "Let Israel rejoice in him that made him." Look at this. "Let the children of Zion," and Zion is the church, "be joyful in their king." See, it's joy. This new song is full of joy. This new song is full of praise. This new song is "let them praise him in the dance." It's full of dance. It's full of praise. It's full of joy. "Let them sing praises unto him with a timbrel and a harp." It's full of instruments. There's a party happening. Anybody know what I'm talking about? It is a good time. Verse 4. "For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He will beautify the meek with," there's the word, "salvation." Now, salvation has not come yet. This is David speaking many hundred years before Jesus had even come to the earth. But he was looking prophetically into a time when there would be a new song, and that new song would be full of joy, full of praise, full of singing, full of dancing, full of musical instruments. And that's going to step on a few denominations because some don't believe in instruments. But that clearly says with a timbrel and a harp and whatever else that you want to beat on. "For the Lord taketh pleasure in his people, he would beautify the meek," because with salvation, he's going to give salvation. The reason they're singing with joy, the reason they're singing with praise, the reason they're singing with all these different things is because there's coming a day in the new song, and that new song is going to be about salvation. Next verse. "Let the saints be joyful in," here we are, "in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. Let the high praise of God be in their mouth." Oh, here we go. "And a two-edged sword in their hand, to execute vengeance upon the heathen and the punishments upon the people, to bind their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron, to execute upon them the judgment written. This honor have all the saints, praise ye the Lord." In other words, what this is saying is there's a coming a new covenant, and that new covenant is this. It's a covenant of salvation. It's a covenant of love. It's a covenant of praise and joy. It's a covenant of a good thing. It's an uplifting covenant. The people are going to sing. They're going to rejoice. It's a covenant of salvation. It's something that's coming to the earth that's going to change mankind. It's a time in history where it was going to invade the planet. And when it invades the planet, it was going to forever change the course of the direction of life. So the way people knew life was going to change, and life is going to change because of this event that's going to take place in the earth. And when the event takes place, they'll be bringing a new song. New covenant brings a new song. The new covenant is a covenant of salvation. It is to bring joy. It's to bring praise. It's to bring singing. It's to bring dancing. It's to bring a good time. It's to lift up the burdens of oppression off of God's people in the way of the Lord. You got that? That's it. Now go to Revelation chapter 5, verse 9. And then we're going to skip this Revelation chapter 6 and pick up where we left off. And they sung a new song, saying, "Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to the glory to God by the blood out of every kindred and tongue of people and every nation." Didn't matter what background you were. Didn't matter if you were Jew or not Jew. You were Greek. Didn't matter. Here it is. I'm submitting to you for you to consider that Psalm 149 was David prophesying of a certain time in history that was going to happen, a certain time in the future that was going to happen, that was going to forever change history, that was going to create a new song in the earth. Okay? I'm telling you, Revelation chapter 5, verse 9 speaks of that time that the new song entered the earth. Okay? So here's the question you have to ask yourself. Is the book of Revelation only futuristic, or has some of the book of Revelation, or a big part of the book of Revelation, or whatever part you want to consider, already happened? How much are you living towards, and how much are you living from? That's the question you have to ask yourself, because your view of the next couple of chapters that I go over, and I won't get very few tonight, just a very few, I'll go through a few verses tonight in chapter 6, maybe get to first part of chapter 7, but I'm not sure. It has everything to do with how you see life. It has everything to see if you're either, you can't say you're more than a conqueror and still think there's something left to happen. You can't say, my God causes all, thanks be unto God who always causes me to triumph, if you still think the jury's still out on your life. Right? You're a winner or you're not. And what determines you being a winner or not is how you see it. Doesn't say that life won't throw you blasts and ups and downs. That's not the issue. The issue is how you see it. Because when you begin to see yourself as a winner through a revelation, through the eyes of a new song, and you have a new song, if the world falls apart in front of you, if the world just falls apart in front of you, it will not dictate or determine your view and your respect and your outlook and your trust and faith in God. Amen. Right? I mean, good things, bad things happen to good people. Right? Not everything is because somebody did something bad. Ask Job. Okay? I know people, they're just sometimes bad things just happen to good people. But when you think bad things happen to good people, you have to determine, even though bad things are happening to you, if you're that good person, you have to determine that you have a good God. Right? And through the ups and downs, it all, at the end, when it all washes away, you still come out on top. You might have some scars, but you still come out on top, right? Because you are in a wrestling match, but not with flesh and blood, but with principalities and powers of the air, wickedness in high places. And I'm going to tell you, just for you to consider, that those wickedness in high places and principalities of the air, a lot of them are right here between your ears. We got to get you going from darkness into light. So what happened is there's a scripture in Corinthians that says, in Matthew 2, it says, that especially Corinthians, it says, Jesus did not come to condemn the world. With John 3:17, I didn't come to condemn the world. I come to save it, right? I come to save it because the world is condemned already. So if you know that a judgment has already been pronounced on the earth because of sin, then the best thing for us to do as Christians is to get our eyes open to escape the judgment. Right? Does that sound all right? So how do you escape it? By knowledge of what he did. Because on the cross, Jesus was judged for all of the sin. The curse was placed upon him. So you have to begin to see him not just dying for you, but he died as you. So now you get to wake up every morning without any condemnation. And the more you understand what he did for you and the layers that we peel off for you, the more you become awakened and aware and knowledgeable of each step along the way, things begin to change for you. Many people are living much less. Paul said it this way. He says, take communion. When you take communion, drink of my blood, eat of my body. How Paul said, as often you're doing that for Jesus when you come together and take communion, he said, here's the problem. He said, many people have slept before their time, died before their time, because their inability or their lack of discerning the Lord's body. The Lord's body is the book of Revelation, is Jesus. Okay? So as I delve into this next part of this, I want you all to get this with me, okay? Let's do it. Revelation chapter 6, and let's go down to about verse 6. There's the black horse. Did we hit the black horse last week? We did, didn't we? Huh? Barely. And when he had opened the third seal, here's where I go, see? This is difficult to go back and forth. The first horse we saw was the white horse. The white horse was Jesus coming into the earth, pure, holy, blameless, without spot, wrinkle, or blemish, or anything. He didn't have a blemish. He had no sin. He was perfect, born of a virgin, came in righteous. He's the only one that's righteous. He's the only one that could take the sin of mankind upon himself. So he entered into, and the beast was a living beast, full of life, okay? That beast told John to come and see. So he's telling the believers, come and see. This is something for you to see. And as you see it, and your eyes get open to it, your life will change accordingly, right? Remember what I said last week? He didn't say come and do. He said come and see. And behold, a black horse. The second was a red horse. The third one was a black horse. And he sat upon it with a pair of balances in his hands. Let's go to the next verse. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts saying, a measure of wheat for a penny and three measures of barley for a penny. I don't have time to go into each feast because if I do, I tried that a little bit last week and I could spend a whole class just on this particular verse. And see thou hurt not the oil and the wine. We talked about the oil and the anointing, the wine being the joy. And when he had opened the fourth seal, now keep in mind there's seven seals. And when he opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast saying, once again, come and see. I got something to show you. And here's what this is saying. If you see this and your eyes get open to it, you'll be able to walk into a realm of living that you didn't know before you could see it. So there's something that you're blind to. There's something you don't even know that you don't know. Right? There's something that's behind the curtain that God wants us to see about Jesus that if we see it, it will change our life. But if you don't see it and you never get behind the curtain, you could live your life having a promise of God and never appropriating it or living in it, which is where a lot of people live. So the fourth beast said, come and see. And he looked, and I looked, and behold, a pale horse. And his name is his nature, that sat on him was, look at this, death and hell. Followed him, and power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with a sword, and with hunger, and with death, and with the beasts of the earth. Now, wait a minute. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth. Now, you were born of the earth, right? You were made of the dust of the ground, which is the earth. So the question is then this. is that some weird, wacky event that's going to happen that we get to turn on sci-fi channel, or we can watch it on some sort of Discovery Channel, and we watch it happen and go, whoa, that is amazing. That's something to be scared about, or that's something to be alarmed by. Or is it something that Jesus did, right, that went inside the earth in you and freed you? It's something he obviously did for you, right? He's the pale horse and the beast that came with this pale horse is the beast that John was talking about, is the eagle, the face of the eagle, which flies high. Now watch how this works. The death and hell followed him. Jesus took the keys to death and hell, right? And took the keys to the death, hell, and the grave. We hear it all the song. We sing the song. He took the keys. It followed him. When Jesus died on the cross, death was conquered, right? Up to that point, men were separated from the Lord, from God. Do you remember this? And I could go into Colossians where it says, you remember when Jesus says that he died, went to hell, his soul went to hell? He goes down to hell, Hades. He goes to hell because death and hell were still in power. Death, a separation from God. Hell, a holding pattern, a holding place for these people. And all the way back to Adam, actually back to Noah, he goes back and God preaches, or Jesus preaches in hell the gospel to all these people. He went back 4,000 years. Do y'all know this to be true? Do you remember when Jesus resurrected and he walked for 40 days amongst the people? And when the earth quaked, the grounds were open and graves were open and men were walking amongst the people? You remember that? And it was people from the old days? Huh? Jesus went to hell, preached the gospel to the captivity there, and he led captivity captive. And he brought the people that were in hell out of hell, that were in Abraham's bosom, and brought him to himself. Did you know that? You got to know that, because here's why. That horse, that death, hell, followed Jesus into death and hell. Jesus comes out with the keys. They don't. They get locked up. That's why we don't worry about death, because we're not without hope when somebody dies today. It's why when I preach a funeral, I can stand in front of the people and say, if I know this person's on his way to heaven and saved, I can stand with a surety and say, to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. How can I say that? Because Jesus took the keys to death and hell. The grave couldn't hold him. Death couldn't stop him, right? And hell isn't big enough to keep him. Jesus split hell wide open. And he let everybody that was back there come forward, right? So they get to partake of what we get to partake of. Oh, my. And power was given over them, the fourth part of the earth, to kill with the sword. The sword is the word of God. The sword is to kill. It is Jesus himself. That word kill right there also means to put to death, which is also the same Greek word where you deny yourself, pick up your cross and follow me. It's talking about your flesh. Okay? Kill with the sword, with the word, and with hunger, and with death, and with the beast of the earth. Stop right there for a second. I'm going to give you the picture of what Jesus did. Luke chapter 4, Jesus gets up out of the water after being baptized. The Spirit of God descended upon him as a dove, right? He was led into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. For how long? 40 days. The devil, Satan, was more subtle or more cunning than any beast of the field, right? This is a picture of Luke chapter 4 when Jesus fasted and hungered. Jesus overcome the temptation and the beasts of the earth and the beasts of the field. It's a picture of Luke chapter 4. Can you see that? Next verse. And when he had opened the fifth seal, all I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God. Do you remember Abel's blood crying out from the earth, from the ground? God says, where I hear Cain, what have you done with your brother? He says, well, I heard his blood crying out from the ground. All these people that had died before, they were held for the word of their testimony. Next verse. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell in the earth? Here's what was, for 4,000 years, people that did believe in God but did not have the new song were in the bosom of Abraham swelling up, crying out, how long will we be held captive? So when Jesus come to the earth, riding the white horse, the red horse, the pale black horse, and the pale horse, and you're going to see there's another seal right here. When you see Jesus coming, these are aspects of what Christ did to set the captive free. All the souls were crying out. This is so he came to set the captive free, not just the one that was living in 2,000 or 2,000 years ago. He came to set the captive free all the way back. He went all the way back, and he went all the way forward. Here's where I get in trouble, okay? Do you remember when Jesus comes and Nathaniel's there? And Nathaniel looks at him and says, he says, I saw you when you were behind that fig tree. And Nathaniel looks at him and says, man, he goes, you must be a prophet seeing me behind a fig tree. He says, you think that's good? He said, I saw you behind a fig tree. He said, from here on out, you're going to see angels ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. You remember what he said? Now, we as Protestant Christians, and I preach this, that Jesus is there and angels are going to go to heaven and come back down and bring things on him. That's a good, it works, okay? And it's probably true as well. However, do you know that he had all the power of God on him anyway? Right? He wasn't subject to some angel playing fetch. He was powerful in himself. But what it did say is behind the fig tree. Here's what God, Jesus was saying to Nathanael. Nathanael, I saw you when you were behind the fig tree. I saw you when you were Adam, in Adam, and Adam had sinned, and Adam had taken figs and hid himself from them. I saw you when you were in Adam hiding behind Adam and hiding behind those fig leaves. Then he says, from this point on, you think that's something? You're going to see angels ascending and descending. Ascending as a ascending order and descending order. It's not just this way. It goes this way. Your ancestors and your descendants and your posterity. It's talking about as far as what you're going to see from this point on, Nathaniel, as far as you can think way ahead, I'm there. As far as you can go all the way back, I'm there too. You're going to see angels going, seven angels, seven seals. Do you all see this? You're going to see me go all the way into the future, so far in the future that you're not going to tell the future from the past. I'm going to go all the way back to Adam, and I'm going to go all the way as far as you can go, as far as the thousand and thousand generations. That's what he says. We think it's this. Here's Jesus, and he gets landed on by, you know, something that hits him, and it's an angel going, whoo, ascending and descending, going forward and going backward, going as far as you can go ahead and as far as you can go behind. You're going to see me going. In fact, I'm going to encapsulate this thing all into one, and you're not going to be able to tell the was, the is, or the is to come. Am I making sense? So when Nathaniel's looking at him, he's going, you think that's crazy? It wasn't that I looked snuck behind there and saw you behind a fig tree. I saw you were in Adam, and I've come to tie this thing all together. And if you can get a hold of who I am and see who I am, it'll change your whole life. So he cried with a loud voice, how long, O Lord, and so true, dost thou judge and avenge our body that the dwell on the earth. Verse 11. Look, and white robes were given unto every one of them. Robes of righteousness were given to every one of them. And it was said to them that they should rest yet for a little season unto their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, here we go, and lo, there was a great earthquake. The sun became black as the sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. It happened on the cross. I could read it to you in Matthew, Luke, and John. And the stars of heaven fell into the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. Stop right there for a second. Okay. What he's saying right here, I'm going to bring this to real clear, I pray. Please help me, Lord. John chapter 12. Jesus is talking to the disciples, and he's telling them about himself. And they're having a little bit of trouble figuring out, well, I don't understand all the sayings you're saying. I mean, we know you're Jesus. We know we believe you're from God. We believe all those things. But there are some things you just say that are hard, and they're just hard to understand. It's hard to follow. We've been walking with you now for a while. We see all these crazy miracles you're doing. You keep talking about heaven. You talk about Father. You talk about that you only do the things you see the Father do. You only say the things you hear the Father say. You're kind of opening up stuff to us that we had no idea was available. I mean, you start talking. You open up. You're giving us power to heal. You're giving us power to cast out devils. Even the devils are scared of us in your name. I mean, things are starting to happen. It's getting kind of crazy. And you're opening this thing up to us, but there are just some things I just don't get what you're saying. This is the disciples. Jesus looks at him and says this. He says, I want you to follow me. He says, and he didn't even answer their question. He just goes at him and he says, listen, there's coming a time that you're going to have to get this because I'm going to have to go away. Now, he's talking, the reason I'm saying John is because it's the eagle. It's the spirit, okay? And he looks at him and he says, listen, guys, there's coming a time I'm going to have to go away, but you can't go where I'm going. So he begins to talk of the things of the spirit. So he now, instead of talking real practical, he's talking spiritually to them that they can only get it by the Spirit. They're not going to get it by just an illustration. You got to catch it. You can't be taught it. Right? So he begins to tell them. He says, guys, I'm going to tear down this body, this temple is going to be destroyed, and in 3 days, it's going to be raised up. Now, there was a temple in Jerusalem already built. It was already there. These guys were thinking, now think about this. Jesus is talking about himself. The guys think he's talking about the building, right? So Jesus looks at him and says, in 3 days, the temple's going to be destroyed, but after 3 days, I'll raise it back up. In their head, they get together and they say, how in the world can he tear down a building that took years to build and now going to build it back in 3 days, right? Now, he says this, he was speaking of himself, right? He looks at them and he says, what's this? I beheld Satan fall from heaven like lightning to the ground in a matter of an instant, like thunder, like lightning. We're in the seal that's being opened now is the one where there's lightning and thunder and quakes, right? And watch, and the stars of heaven fell. Do you remember in Revelation chapter 12? We're gonna go here too. When we go here, we don't go tonight, but when you hear this, you're gonna see this isn't like you think it is. Where a third of the angels fell, followed after Satan, right? All right? And the stars of heaven fell into the earth, even as a fig tree cast her untimely figs when she's shaken by the wind. He says to them in John chapter 12, he says, guys, listen, I beheld Satan. I was there. I watched it. I physically saw Satan try to take over heaven. Now, if you think that's Star Wars or planet of some other planet, you'll miss what's really happening. Because what he's saying is, I was there when Satan tried to get eternity in man. I was there when Satan tried to talk man into giving up their eternal value for term limits. Man became terminal, right? Became, now, that's that right there, was a, that's a Lord. That's that new song. I told you it was a song and horns and, yeah. You see what I'm saying? He said inside, I was there when they were trying, I beheld Satan fall to the earth, the ground, right? I was there when he went from trying to interrupt heaven to earth. I was there. Here's what he said. I was there. I beheld him as lightning fall. He said, next verse, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. That word draw means drag. I would drag men, all men. Some men, all men. I'll drag them to me if I be lifted up. So the church, in our limited perspective, like the disciples, what we have done when we hear him say that, the disciples said, how's he gonna tear down a building and build it back up in 3 days? What we've done when we hear the next part of that scripture that says, not only am I gonna tear it down and build it back up, but if I be lifted up, I'll drag all men to me. What we've done is, let's write a song. We'll write a song about it because if we lift him up in praise and worship, if we sing and lift him up, that's what we think. He'll draw all men to him. But we didn't get the next passage of scripture. The next passage of scripture doesn't say anything about praise and worship. It says, here's what he says. I beheld Satan fall from lightning, like lightning fall from to the ground. If I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. This he spoke of the death that he must take. It was the cross. It was his death, his burial, and his resurrection that draws all men to him. How you lift up God is lift up the cross. How you lift up Jesus is lift up what took place 2,000 years ago. You lift him up is when you give him honor of what he did. So we have been in a level of deception, just ignorance. It's not even deception, it's just ignorance. We have not known because we have looked at every one of these seals thinking that there's an event that's about to happen out there somewhere, that those seals are going, and I got one friend of mine, he's a good guy, good friend of mine, and I'm sure it's prophetic in nature in the future too. But if you only see what will be, you'll miss what is and what was. That's important. If you think Jesus is only what it will be, you'll miss what he has already done. And we're living today in what he is done and what he is doing. It's every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. That's what he told Satan when he got tempted on the Luke chapter 4. You live by every word that proceedeth, continually coming out, current, fresh revelation that happens today. And what we've done is we've got caught up in all this kind of stuff and we've missed so much of what God has already done. So every seal that is unlocked inside of a person, because I read it to you last week in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 12, it says, you have been sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. So as the seal gets loosed from you, unlocked from you, every time there's a seal unlocked and you're able to see it, come see. The seal is unlocked, the Lamb unlocks it, you see it, you're changed, your perspective is different, now you begin to live out of a fresh perspective. Every horse, every seal gets unlocked inside of you. My question to you, there's seven seals, how many of those seven seals have fully been unlocked in you, or how many of those things are still inside of you that you still have not seen? And I'm telling you, every time a seal is broken, opened up, it's a level of freedom and a level of liberty in you because you get to see what he's done for you. Am I making any sense? Next verse. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it rolled together. And every mountain and island were moved out of their places. Guys, I can go back to Matthew, Mark, and Luke and read these to you. This happened on the cross. Go ahead. And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich men and the chief captains and the mighty men and every bondman and every free man hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains. And I got to, see, I have not even got past six, verse chapter 6. It's 8:02. And said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from, ooh, look at this, and from the wrath of God. Here's what I'm going to say to you tonight. I want you to get this, please. If you can get this inside of your heart, I think I can go into the verse part of chapter 7 and at least leave you something hanging, okay? If you can get this. Because Adam's sin, you are condemned already. Every time a seal is unlocked inside of you by the Lamb, you walk out of condemnation into the Spirit. Right? So you as a, that's what discipleship is all about, make them disciples. He didn't say make a bunch of people make decisions. Making a decision for Christ. The gospel is not you accepting Jesus. The gospel is Jesus accepted you. Now what are you going to do about it? He forgave your sins whether you like it or not. Now what are you going to do? He's not holding it against you. So you either got to learn that that's true and live out of that reality, or you stay in the bondage of fear. Am I making any sense at all? I mean, this is really, really clear. If I went down to the bank and paid off your mortgage and gave you and sent you the paid mortgage or the deed and deed of trust back to your house and you got it says paid in full, and then you go down there and try to pay the payment next month, they're not going to take your money. Why? It's paid in full. So you either live out of a paid in full life or you're always trying to pay a debt you can't pay. And I'm telling you, the unveiling of Christ in you is the hope of glory. Not one day to see him on the internet when he comes back. We got, one preacher said, now that we got satellite all over the world, every eye will see him. In a twinkling of an eye, they'll see him. I got news for you. A twinkling of an eye is the day your eye got open and you went from lost to saved. Twinkle. I can. Am I okay? You aren't getting mad at me, are you? Please. Let's do it one more time. Let's go another verse. Gosh, I want you to get this. For the great day of his wrath has come. His wrath is not on you. It's on the enemies of you.
That's good.
His wrath is not, God is not angry with you. He said there's a comfort. The day the new song come, the new covenant come, he is not going to be striving with man. So how can he be, he would be a liar if he's striving with you, angry with you, in wrath towards you. After saying he made a covenant. And the covenant is not with you. The covenant is with himself. By believing in the covenant he made with himself makes you a candidate for that promise. So it's not a matter of I got to keep the rules or otherwise we break the covenant. He made a covenant with himself. The Father and the Son made a covenant. The blood was the cut covenant of the that made the blood the cut covenant. He sealed it with the blood. And now that Christ dwells in you, you have the fullness of that whole Godhead in you, and the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the grave, these cannot be scriptures that we quote, sing, shout, and hope. They've got to become a living reality for us, guys. Amen. It has to become a living reality. Man, if you only knew the power. Stacy's over there, there's a kid that plays football for us, and he's a little fella, but he's a little stocky. He has never played football before. Stacy grabbed me by the pads the other night, and he said, man, if you only knew the force that you were, if you only knew what you had, that kid's looking up at him like, wow, I haven't heard that before in my life. And he kept saying, boom, if you only knew, and the kid's starting to believe, So then Stacy starts teaching him things, technique, and the kid starts seeing it, and his eyes start opening up to the reality of what Stacy saw before the kid even was in him. That's you.
Amen.
Jesus gave the disciples power for 70 of them. They go away to heal the sick. They're casting out devils. They're turning it upside. And the reason they had all that power wasn't to go put on a demonstration. It was to set the captive free. It was to eliminate hardships in people's life. It was to put the enemy back on his heel. I beheld Satan fall like lightning to the ground. When is the last time you have said that? Behold, I saw. I beheld. That's what he says. I beheld. I witnessed. I saw. I was there. It's a current event for me. I saw. I beheld Satan fall like lightning. When's the last time somebody you know that's bound, whether it be with drugs, alcohol, sickness, disease, mental oppression, depression, whatever it might be, just life, just strongholds, and you have the seal that's unlocked in you, and the revelation of the Lamb lives inside of you, and the power of the revelation of the Lamb lives inside of you, and you walk up to somebody that's in that condition, and you are able to say, behold, I beheld Satan fall like lightning to the ground. And you went, Satan, fall, like depression, go. Oppression, go. Sickness, go. Confusion, go. Anxiety, go. Addiction, go. And I'm not talking about for a minute. I'm not talking about just give me a little bit of free till I get my breath back and you can come back and we'll fight again tomorrow or the next day. I'm talking about leave. That's not going to happen into the believer's life. And God has brought us to the earth and leaving us on the earth as kings and priests unto God. Revelation chapter 5, verse 12. We are kings and priests unto him and agents on the earth to what? To do exactly what I'm saying. To be the representation of the revealing of Jesus. But you can't reveal him out there if you don't know him in here. I don't care how many sci-fi prophetic words you know. I mean, I've got people telling me, I had a guy call me today. I was right in the middle of studying and had 1,000 things going on. He calls me up and he goes, listen, I got to tell you, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me about Trump, Schumer, and he starts talking about all this politics. And I said, my God, you know, I appreciate all that. And he had I got some insight here. I feel like this is from the Lord. And all of a sudden, this rose up inside of me. I said, how's your daughter? And he went, man, she's really having a hard time. So when was the last time you talked to her? He said, I can't even go around her. She's so bad. I said, really? He said, yeah. I said, how about me you run over and talk to her tomorrow or Friday? He said, you want to go over there? I said, I would much rather go talk to your daughter so I can say, behold, amen. I saw Satan fall like lightning to the ground. Then stand here and talk about Donald Trump and Charles Schumer and all these different people that are fighting over the. I'm telling you guys, I'm not against watching that. You should be informed. But if that is forming you, you need to be transformed because you're becoming conformed. Amen. I couldn't say it again. I don't know what I just said. Do you hear what you guys get what I'm saying? This has got to become a reality. I mean, if you have more insight of what's going to happen and your relationships are struggling internally, we got some work to do. I got to unlock a seal. And if you unlock a seal inside of you and all you can see is the white horse, the black horse, the red horse, the pale horse that is going to one day be the Antichrist, and you don't know that John says that Antichrist, the spirit of Antichrist is here already, it's working in your life and working against you. If you don't know that already, it doesn't do you any good to keep looking for what's happening from the Muslim that's going to come across the earth. I'm not nutting down in all that stuff. I'm just tired of the church getting beat up half to death while we're still looking for something else to happen. We're taking the cross in vain. That's the most powerful event in human history, is the cross, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the church hangs a hat on a moment in time back then, and it has very little power in us today. And that's got to change. And the only way it's going to change is when we get the revealing and revelation of what's taking place inside of you. We have got to loose those seals. And the only one that can loose those seals is the Lamb. And the only person that can preach it is the angels, which is the messengers of God. They're just not seven angels and seven specific angels. Angel means messenger, it means pastor, it means preacher, it means teacher. It means somebody that can apostolically come and unlock and talk about this. If somebody's talking about themselves, they're not talking about the Lamb. If they're trying to build a ministry, they're not talking about the Lamb. If it's all about money, they're not talking about the Lamb. If it's all about their music ministry, it's not about the Lamb. He's the Lamb. He's the King. He's the Lord. He's the Savior. He's the only one worthy to open up the book. And guess what? You're the book. You're the epistle that is trying to be read by men. And the only one worthy to open up the book is the Lamb in your life. So the more revelation you get about the Lamb, the more you're walking in authority and revelation of power and demonstration of the power. So he says, eat of my body, drink of my blood. We've drank the blood, so we're really good about getting our sins forgiven. But I'm here to feast on the Lamb. It's time to cook up some lamb. And guess who's gonna bring it to us? The horses. The horses are gonna bring us the meal of the Lamb that's gonna unlock the seal to release power in your life. I gotta quit right there. Would you stand with me? You're getting out early tonight. Somebody said, thank God. No, okay, that's fine. You got a song? Okay. Should have said you got a new song. Is this helping anybody? Can you do me a favor real fast, because I am going to close. Can you pull up Revelation chapter 7, verse 1, real fast, and I'll give you a little taste of next week. I'm determined to get this thing done by October. Listen to this. And after these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. Next verse. And I saw another angel ascending from east and having the seal of the living God. Oh, here we go. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, oh, here we go, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of God in their foreheads. What's it say, in their foreheads or on their foreheads? It's not gonna be a seal on your forehead. It's gonna be a mark in your forehead. And the forehead is that mind. You're gonna see. Don't worry about, I'm not gonna go there. Father, I need help. I need help on articulating and piecing together how to communicate the things of the Spirit to your people. It pops like popcorn in my mind, in my head. Revelation and Scripture keeps coming back. And sometimes, Lord, it just kind of moves all over like a pinball machine, and they kind of have to have their bumpers up just to keep it moving up, to keep catching it. I need the Lord, by the power of your Spirit, to connect all these dots in their mind way more than what I'm even saying. I need you to bring Scriptures back to their remembrance. Things they may have heard or maybe have never heard before. And you put it all together and piece it together and you snap it together that it can't be broken or pulled apart. And let it be a puzzle and a picture that you're snapping together that they're starting to see. Let the reality of that picture become a picture they realize it's not just on the front of a box of a book, of a puzzle. It's a book that of their life that they get the privilege of living in and living out of. Now, Lord, your people are so many of us are bound in so many different areas of our life, and we need the seals loosened. And we've tried loosening them with so many different ways and thoughts. We've tried scriptures and doctrine, and we've quoted things, and we've read Mark 11, 22, 23, and 24, and we quoted it and bought the t-shirt. We did all that, Lord, and it's helped us in so many different ways. But Lord, we're ready for a deeper revelation that this thing known as the Lamb, the Christ, the Son of the living God, the kingdom of God, becomes a living experience for us. Not just a thought, not just an idea, not just a hope, but a living reality that we experience in every aspect of our life. Loose your people in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you guys. See y'all on Sunday morning.